And he has a straight draw. So this is a great spot to semi-bluff. That's what it's called when you bet with a hand that's almost certainly not good at the moment. But if you bet, you can pick up the pot. So he bets, and now Jake Cody thinks for a bit before calling. I think that this is a fine spot for Jake Cody to call and see what happens. He doesn't love this spot, but notice there are a bunch of draws available. Jonathan Jaffe could easily have a hand like King-Queen, Queen-9, 9-8, stuff like that. So he can very easily be bluffing with a draw, semi-bluffing like he is. All right, so the river is the Eight of Spades, giving Jonathan Jaffe a straight. That's exactly what he was wanting, although he preferred not to be the Eight of Spades. So Jonathan Jaffe's going to make a value bet, which is certainly in line. You're not really so concerned that your opponent has a flush heads up. Of course, he could have it, but you can easily bet here and get called by a jack or a 10, maybe an 8. So there is a lot of value to be had in betting. So he gives it some thought. Let's see how much he makes it. He takes his time. Actually, Jonathan Jaffe is known to play pretty quick, so that is worth mentioning. You can take a look at the player's time banks. You'll see Jonathan Jaffe has significantly more time bank than Jake Cody. So anyway, Jonathan Jaffe bets two-thirds pot, 6,500 into the 10,200 pot with his straight. And now Jake Cody, it looks like he has a pretty easy fold because he has ace high. Everything got there. He shouldn't really mess around too much. But notice here Jake Cody has the ace of spades in his hand. And imagine if Jake Cody had ace five of spades instead of ace of spades five of clubs. What would he do in this spot? Well, he would certainly raise. So Jake Cody can use this hand as a bluff. This is called bluffing with a blocker. And in theory, Jake would like to have a different card than the five in his hand. I mean, the five blocks 7-5, meaning it's less likely for Jonathan Jaffe to have a five in his hand. But Jake Cody would rather have something like a nine in his hand because queen nine and 9-7 are straights that make a whole lot of sense as well. So Jake Cody would prefer to have one of those cards, but I don't think the five matters so much. The most relevant factor here is the ace of spades. So how much would Jake Cody make it with a flush? That's what he wants to ask himself. And given that he would certainly raise with all of his nut hands, he also wants to do this with some number of bluffs. So which hands make the most sense to bluff? Well, it's the hands that can't win at showdown that also have a blocker. And in this spot, that's ace of spades with another card. So he makes it 29,500. A big raise. He doesn't quite put Jonathan Jaffe all in. I don't know if he made that size for a specific reason, or if this is just the size he would make it with his nuts and his bluffs. It's probably the case. He's probably doing it with both hands. And after a while, Jonathan Jaffe, who I am terrified of trying to bluff. I don't think I've ever tried to bluff Jonathan Jaffe in my life, because he always calls me. He gives it a bunch of thought. And notice, he looks pretty unhappy. And I was just pretty convinced he was going to call here. But notice here, he actually loses to queen 9, 9-7, and all the flushes. And this is a spot where Jake Cody would almost certainly play all of those hands in this exact manner. Maybe he doesn't have 9-7 too often, but he could. And he could certainly have queen 9, although maybe he bets queen 9 on the flop. But the backdoor flushes are the cards that really make, or are the hands that really make a lot of sense. So Jake Cody properly realized this is a great spot to go for it. I actually watched this hand on the Global Poker League. I commentated it, and I tried this exact play online the next day when I was playing, and my opponent bet the river. I shoved all in for about three times his bet. He thought for forever and then folded. I had the ace high blocker, and it worked great. Let's see if this one works out for him. This may be how the money makers lose their money. Jonathan Jaffe's still giving it thought. He's very unhappy about this, and he makes the fold.
Thanks
so
for lay down.
Huge lay down there by Jonathan Jaffe, and this just shows you the power of this bluff versus players who are competent and can read hands. If Jonathan Jaffe is just a player who looks at his hand and says, well, I have a straight, I call, no problem, or I have trips, I call, or I have a set, I call, maybe that's not the type of player you want to do this against. But against someone who's smart and can hand read reasonably well, it's a pretty powerful play.
This is a play that you'd see perhaps slightly less often in heads-up play, just because of the fact that the hand rankings, you know, gain value. I mean, a straight in heads-up is, you know, kind of often seen as the nuts or close to, compared with a hand that's played out multi ways.
Well, I think it really depends on the situation, because
it takes confidence to wear a shirt like that.
No, that's just a baller shirt. That's just great. That's a boss man shirt, right?
Yeah.
Less sound on computer. Will you hear me as well as before?
We hear you, Sergey.
I'm not sure.
Walter could be in the nude.
We hope Malta Trekiriki is not in the nude.
Well, it doesn't matter. You can't tell.
We don't want to violate the terms of YouTube, which we're currently broadcasting to you on, while we hope and wait for our Twitch to resolve their issues.
So many draws here, and have second pair. Not very good river for me.
Pretty good.
No, not a good river.
Well,
now he loses.
He was losing anyway.
Well,
I have not enough to make long bluff. Don't want to just bet one time. Maybe if he'll show some weakness, or a card like this, I should bluff. No other possibilities. I think. That's what good.
Very good understanding of hand ranges by Sergey.
A lot of sevens. And now he has not a lot of queens. So even if he has 10, probably I can bluff him out on the river, not on the turn, of course.
That was, of course, Sergey Lebedev's ringtone. All GPL players compelled to have the GPL music.
You hear me well?
It's important to understand when you do 3-bet with a garbage hand like the 5-2 suited that you don't have to just blindly barrel off every single time.
I played a little bit with Walter yesterday and saying that he is very creative player. He limps through bet against me with 10 deuce suited. So I'm ready to some interesting hands.
He's ready to tango. Sergey Lebedev is 18th on the all-time money list for Russia.
Small bet here, I think.
Russia's a big country.
Big country.
A lot of times.
Possibly the biggest, Jonathan.
Yeah. Americans and our geography, we're not so good at it.
Yeah, I've discovered that over the years.
America's not the biggest country? It has to be. All right, so here we have raise and defend. Let's see if Walter sticks around. I imagine he will. Here he has a lot of backdoor draws, but Sergey just doesn't even bet.
Not much. No, it's a little bit better. No sense to bet turn. We are ahead a lot of times. And it will not fold any pair. I think I will have here enough hands to call and fold queen high.
GPL is back on Twitch, guys. Thank you for your patience. On this occasion, we were completely blameless. This was a Twitch issue.
Blame Scott Ball. Blame the Las Vegas moneymakers.
Tweet at Scott Ball, at Rumcakes, I believe. Thank you for your patience. This is Walter Trekiriki.
There's some problems with connection. My internet last 2-3 days. Not so stable. I think I should call his high at least once.
Sergey Lebedev's internet, less stable than Eastern Ukraine.
Even without any backdoors.
So there's Sergey recognizing that if he's folding out ace high on this board, he's probably going to be folding out a little bit too much to where Walter has a very easy, profitable bet with his entire range.
Not turn.
Walter likes to keep firing. That's pretty aggressive. It's a hand many players would just get out of the way with and just give up, but Walter flopped a few backdoor draws. Didn't turn any, but he didn't care. Just fire away.
Really strong performance needed from Walter Trekiki. The Rome Emperor's currently set bottom of the Eurasian Conference as a result of the incredible week had by the Berlin Bears. 113 points for the Empress. 3 points behind the Paris Aviators. 7 points behind the Hong Kong Stars.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting.
Always something middle. Middle pair, middle value. I will bet 29 here. Pair, maybe, maybe not. But not only one king. That was a small bet. Let's see.
Looks him up. Pretty light in the end.
Yeah, there he beats a lot of bluffs. But if Walter's betting all nines, and maybe even some two pairs, it's probably a little bit too thin. But if he's mainly betting aces and just, you know, maybe not even all of his nines, then it's probably okay. Definitely depends on how thin your opponent's going. Unlike the Americas Conference, where Montreal and LA are pretty much locks to get in the playoffs, in the Eurasia Conference, I don't think any team is a super lock yet. I mean, Moscow is at the top of the league, but only 27 points separate them from the Rome Emperors. And if Walter gets a sweep today, it's going to be, well, fewer than that. And you know, it's going to be a very close race in the Eurasia Conference.
Absolutely. But, I mean, we'd see a pretty catastrophic collapse by the Moscow Wolverines.
Then you could bluff one time forever.
I mean, imagine if they don't get any more points. If they get no more points, they're out.
Anything's possible.
Old ace high. King high for sure. Maybe ace high also.
Whereas in the America Conference, Montreal can probably just get no points for the rest of the time and still sneak in third or fourth.
Or betting, like, we have medium value, some tens. I will not bet turn and all nines. I will not bet turn and bet river.
So notice Sergey mentioning all the hands that he would play exactly this way. So that means he can have some bluffs in his range if he would play many value hands in this manner. And obviously the nut low is a strong candidate for bluffing. It's kind of interesting. I'm not sure if he's going to get Walter off many hands, but he does get him off that bottom or second pair there. It's always nice when that works.
First, really good hand.
It's okay, picking up a premium hand.
It's time to throw at me.
After electing to 3-bet the King Deuce off, much to the delight of Sergey.
Works. First good hand. And your opponent 3-bet you. And we are starting nice from the beginning. Just with increased blinds.
Thank you, Eric Denis, for pointing out the three largest countries of the world to aid my ribbing of Jonathan's lack of geographical knowledge.
More.
Interesting hand developing here.
Okay. I agree.
I'm going to go with Russia.
Correct.
China.
Incorrect.
Wow. And India.
Nope. One of those was correct, the one I'd already told you.
Wow, I got them all wrong?
You got two and three wrong.
Oh, that's horrible. What are they?
Not many hands.
Canada
and
the USA.
These.
Really?
But some
well, according
hands
to Eric Denis.
No, he's messing with me.
Pretty interesting flop pot developing here.
Just a call, and that's going to likely save Walter and keep him out of trouble.
Sometimes he's floating me. Sometimes he has weak draw. Maybe ace high. Not many king high. I think it's better to check here.
Oh wow.
Not like this card, but could not fold if it will be not too big bet.
So Walter should almost certainly go for value here to try to get called by ace high and whatnot. Because a lot of ace highs will just check behind.
Some threes here. Flush.
Yeah, I wasn't buying it, but Russia is the biggest by far, followed by Canada, which is a bit larger than America. Man, oh man. Countries with the most surface area. China is number four. Let's see if India is number five. No, Brazil is number five, then Australia, then India.
Eric Denis normally provides accurate data.
Population, though, it goes China, India, and then the United States. And Indonesia, which is actually a tiny country. Very interesting. Yeah, Geohive.com.
China's population is in the billions. So, I mean, you know, they're sort of way out in front on the population side of things. If you have a billion.
All right, so I got three out of the top five, okay? Give me a break.
Yeah, all right. This is last day, guys.
I missed the egotistical pick of America and Canada. Two fantastic hands, 9-4 suited and 9-3 offsuit. No huge confrontations yet, mainly because both players are just playing a somewhat defensive game. Neither player is going bonkers. We did see Walter fire two barrels earlier.
As it was yesterday, second game, there was a triplet there, then card bad.
Shout out everyone on Twitch. Back up and running, I believe. Thank you for anyone's patience who's in any way affected by our connection issues with Twitch.
I think it is time to start limping. They're pretty short already. Just a little more than 20 BBs. Nice flop.
Very nice flop. That's an understatement.
Pretty interesting contrast in the way Sergei Lebedev reacts to flopping trips compared with Jeff Gross in our previous match.
Yeah, Jeff Gross was incredibly excited. And Sergei was excited too. He just shows it differently.
On the inside.
Go all in.
A couple of good hands here.
We will see an all-in.
See an all-in. 25 big blinds.
Wow, this would be a snug fold.
Ooh.
It's a little bit snug. Obviously, good fold though. He probably thinks Sergei is only shoving big cards.
Folded three. I wasn't sure he will fold ace there on Jack 10-9 three deuce. One more limp. Folded three.
Notice Sergei watching the stream, realizing that he did make Walter fold a pair. It's hard to fold a pair. Especially when the pot's not very big. Perhaps a bit of a cooler here for Walter, especially if they put a diamond on the turn.
I'd like to bet small here. This type of board. Many draws.
Walter does pick up the flush draw here.
I think I can take free river. I bet and Shio will be difficult decision.
Notice Sergei not wanting to get pushed off of this hand, so he just checks behind. I mean, at some point your hand becomes a marginal showdown value hand, and it's always hard to know where that line is, but I think King 10 is, you know, below that line where you're not trying to bet for three streets of value anymore.
River.
And now you induce some bluffs. You don't get blown off your hand.
Again, we have the same stakes.
That was just a good control of the pot there by Sergei. He made it impossible to lose, impossible to get bluffed. And he also induces bluffs. So that's exactly what you want to be doing with your marginal hands.
Got a shot here for Sergei.
Let's see how Sergei plays this. This is an interesting one. Assuming Walter bets.
They have much more fives here than he has. Probably same. I have seven of clubs also. So I will try to make
Here we go, buckle up.
Small.
Well, it's just gonna work.
Raise. F5. I think he will shove many times, so at least I will see the turn.
Sweet play there by Sergey. It's hard to defend when they check raise on those like middle card paired boards. And really, based on their sizing, you often have to defend with stuff like ace high, and it gets really nasty. So most players fold out a little bit too prematurely in that spot. Of course, the queen high fold was fine, but it's a tough spot. I'm like, imagine you have ace four.
I don't really know how Walter playing in short stacks. Let's see. So far, not too aggressive. So, I think first limb.
Sizable all in.
Rare is strong, so I can shove suited, connected hand, like 6-4.
It's a pretty sweet play, because when you do get called, you often have some equity. It's not like you're just dead.
I can.
Hello. Oh, how cute!
I could limp.
Bring her back!
Suited. But so far, Walter played tight, so maybe probably it is better to steal this kind of hand. And this kind of hand will try to trap him. After playing tight for a long time, no, he checked. So this kind of flop is good for opponent who checked from big blind, so I'm not going to see bad here. I think in this short stacks he's playing more his cards, not too much bluff here. Still, I think I should call at least one with ace high. He can have some draws, and I think he will not bluff them on this kind of river.
So relax to give up. Down to 15 big blinds.
Walter's not going to be happy about that one. It's a spot where maybe he could have stolen the pot, but at the same time, it's tough to know because that's a situation where Sergey is going to call with all of his made hands and all of his ace highs.
Oh, thank you.
Then it's just going to be folding out a lot of those on the later streets. So, tough spot. I mean, that's what happens when your opponent doesn't raise too often with their made hands. They just call, and then you don't really have a good option because they're going to call you sometimes, and they're going to fold sometimes. It's hard to know when you need to be bluffing in those spots.
Small ball.
But you do need to bluff sometimes. You can't just give up every time.
I already saw that I limped in with ace 10. So, I will not bluff. Is all ins many times pre-flop.
Wow. Aggressive line by Walter.
Walter getting frisky in his dungeon.
Walter the Warlock?
And, well, yeah. I mean, Walter the Minotaur.
Minotaur. That's how they say the word Minotaur in England?
I mean, you know, I'm talking about the, was it Perseus and the Minotaur? Lives in a dark labyrinth.
Yeah, Perseus and the Minotaur.
Oh, no way. Absolutely not, Jonathan. Get out of this booth.
That's
all right.
Oh, top two pair for Walter.
Not a good spot for Sergey.
Call. Will be not so good for me. So it is no draws at all here, so he could have here king, pair of eight.
Ooh, king and
which
eight.
One is no good for me. So maybe sometimes some ace highs, I'm not sure. A lot,
It's a nice run out for Sergei to get off the hook.
No beats. Way to call the river.
Nothing that.
Well, ace high. Beats ace high. Beats maybe some queen high.
She bluffs me. This hand's like queen 10 or something like that. So, well played.
Well, Zeshin says he can beat nothing that calls with a pair on the flop.
But there are a lot of hands that don't have pairs that will call. Especially on a board that dry. Good discipline by Walter, or by Sergei, just getting right off the hook with those pocket jacks, losing a tiny amount, I believe about 10,000 chips. Four big blinds, or five big blinds, something like that. If you get pocket jacks and you lose heads up and lose five big blinds, you're pretty happy. The hard part about poker is you never really know if you make the right fold or not. Unless you're playing on the Global Poker League and you see it 10 minutes later.
Walter's ahead again.
Two queen four offsuits. Walter likes to steal it. He says, that's my pot.
This is the Global Poker League, guys.
Was it Walter
Where's
or Sergey?
Premiums.
Who ran the big bluff with the 9-5 suited?
That was Sergey Lebedev.
So Sergey, we've seen Sergey steal some pots as well.
Close.
Yesterday, I believe.
Call? Yeah, and be sure to tune in to
start the Tolim in short in small stacks. So first trace, I think.
Sure to stay tuned on breaks, guys. Jonathan Little takes us through the key hands of the week on the GPL. Really good hands in there. One of them involving Sergei Lebedev and Fabrice Soulier. Where we see a really kind of nice and sort of out of the blue bluff from Sergei. Just decided to go nuts and works out pretty well.
Yeah, he recognized he had a very tight image and he went for it. He's not afraid. Here you see a limp and a pretty big jam from Ace 2 offsuit, which is perfectly fine. We will very likely see an all-in confrontation at some point in the near future. This is likely a limp call of a jam.
Nice flop.
Pretty nice.
I think many possibilities to win big hand sometimes. Walter has Jack 5.
About to head into the 1,500-3,000 level, which is going to put these guys both below.
Who will be lucky? That's the question. 10-5? He blasts me out.
Yeah, I was pretty surprised at that one too. Sergei's looking at the
turn. Would not bluff here. Try to catch my spade.
He catches.
Not a good call card for Walter at all. He's probably just giving up every time now.
Please lay down in the end for Walter.
He had king and eight. So many full houses.
We are back to the 1,400, 2,800 level. Apologies for the misleading sentiments that I gave over, saying that we were suggesting we were going to 1,500, 3,000. Of course, we don't miss off any levels here at the GPL.
Great structure in these heads-up games so they can get finished in about 20 minutes, huh? That's why we play best of three.
Yeah. Hand 47 in this game.
It's always interesting whenever they're structuring heads-up tournaments. Do they do best of three with kind of fast structures, or do they do one match with a much slower structure? And I think most pros generally prefer this faster structure, but two out of three. Because then it's not just like one big hand that settles the game every time. You often have multiple big hands that settle the match.
Walter Trikiariki, our vampire friend, not getting the action he was hoping for with aces, and not getting the action he was hoping for with aces.
Sharp. So small stakes. Cannot play so many hands as before. Yeah. High. Good shot. The queen. Interesting card. I think I should check call one more time here.
Wow. Really unfortunate river.
I don't think I should bluff with queen high here. Of course he will fold ace high, not so many ace highs. He will not fold 10 or king. It's close. Can try to check raise. Force very unlucky. Unlucky.
We haven't seen any cooler hands, Jonathan, so far that probably would have ended the game, you know, or should have ended the game by now. Both, always one of them seems to have junk when the other one picks up a hand.
Yeah, that happens sometimes. That's just part of poker.
Yeah.
Like, imagine you sit there and deal out hands two at a time. It's going to take you quite a while to get two really strong hands. But, of course, in heads up, if you give one guy ace nine and the other one king queen, they're all in. Let's see how Sergey plays this ace four offsuit. He does just select a shove. And it feels kind of dirty shoving with this ace four because when you get called, you're often
are
in
we going
marginal shape.
Finish this one?
Sergey could limp call this. He limps. This may be the end of this one.
No. Shove or
nope.
Limp is better.
Rough flop for Sergey.
Krusty asks, who's talking? Well, the one who can't put a sentence together is me, Jonathan Little. I'm part of the Las Vegas Moneymakers.
Oh, and I'm Roland in the booth, Boothby. I'm part of the team here at GPL. I'll be taking you through the next 4 weeks of GPL after this week, heading towards the Summer Series in the playoffs in Las Vegas.
So
Summer
much.
Series has already taken place.
Got shots on the flop. So.
I'm going home tomorrow.
Lamentable. But true.
And then we have the two players. We have Sergey Lebedev and Walter Trecchierici.
Moscow Wolverines and the Rome Emperors, respectively, both representing their country of birth.
It's better to raise here. So. Eight.
Interesting small raise finally from Sergey, given he's been shoving a lot. He was shoving hands that make a lot of sense to shove. But it's exciting for me to see that he has a bluffing range. Well, he has a small raise value range, which kind of implies he has a small raise bluffing range, I assume. And, you know, Walter just gets off the hook.
The big.
Yeah, a bunch of bad hands.
Generally,
not fault. Suited hand. One man raise.
Fairly snug play from these guys.
So, I have bottom pair. I have two backdoors.
Bit of an action card.
Pretty great card for Walter.
An interesting river. pair and 4 flash bar.
And 4 straight board.
Don't think he has many 4s.
He has both a 4 and a flush.
Chevalier is king.
Big bet. Nice.
Interesting.
It's an interesting hand to do this with, because
come on, Nero.
Typically you want to be making these shoves with the nuts, but
interesting bet.
Walter probably thinks that Sergey doesn't have very many aces and kings.
Great, creative player
of diamonds.
So
let's kind go.
Of ace have here. Of diamond, some ace of diamond. He value bet small with small bets before, and here it is small over bet.
Please
and I have no ace in my range. And if I, he thinks that if I will have king or jack or 10 of diamond, I'll bet it myself. So.
I think Sergey's going to find the call here.
Oh.
And he does.
That's good.
Sweet value bet from Walter.
Come on.
I certainly do not fault Sergey for that call there. As he said, analyzing his range, he does not have any aces. Maybe Walter doesn't even shove a king. Maybe he doesn't shove the jack. He did shove the jack. And that gave Walter some points.
Yeah, really kind of interesting conclusion to that game. Up to that point, we hadn't really seen many premium hands in the possessed by each player. And suddenly, you know, thinking, both of us thinking that it would require a cooler to get this game ended. And as it happened, it was a very kind of sort of, well, hand that played out all, you know, flop, turn, and river. And Walter, who hadn't really got out of line too often in... you know, in big pots, shoved river, and Sergey decided to look him up.
Yeah, I mean, you have to realize that Walter is representing primarily the nuts or nothing. And it's kind of hard for him to have the nuts, but at the same time, Sergey realizes that he himself cannot have the nuts. So if you know that, if I know that I can't have the nuts, and you very easily could have the nuts, well, it puts me in a rough spot, because you can... The best hand in my range now is like the king or the jack of diamonds. And I may bet the king or the jack of diamonds myself, because that's a really good hand. So it's a pretty tough spot to be in, and it often makes you think that your opponent's going to be bluffing perhaps more than they are, because they should be betting you. They should be trying to bet you off of your obviously marginal made hand when they have nothing. And that's why Sergey decided to make the call, and I certainly do not fault him for it. That's a great spot to bluff. And Walter recognized this and actually value bet a little bit thin. A lot of people don't overbet with the jack high flush in that spot because they fear that they want maybe against the king or the ace. But Walter recognized that and got full value.
Yeah, I feel like Sergey possibly didn't really get the run of the cards in that one. It was very much a sort of a cagey game. Both players, as you sort of predicted, playing a bit more GTO than we saw on our first game. I think kind of one of the illustrators of how, you know, how slightly more tight that game was. We saw it was Walter raising ace four of hearts on the button. I think Sergey three bet shoved ace eight, and although we thought we were actually going to go to the you know, all in there, but you know. Both players are opting for a slightly tighter strategy in that match.
Yeah, I think that the call with ace four suited there would have been fine. I don't think anyone would have faulted him, but Walter actually folded, and he ended up winning the game. So if he made that big call with the ace four suited, as you will see some players do, he would likely have lost. But instead, he played a little bit snug, found himself a better spot, made a good overbet on the river, and he got 3 points.
So guys, just to clarify, that's 1-0 to the Rome Emperors. 3 points on the board for the team that need it most in this division. And we're going to go right off to the second game where both players are ready to go.
I think we should make it binding that they have to get avatars and pictures of themselves that actually look like them in their homes. Because these people don't look anything the same.
Or they have to dress in their homes in a similar way to how they appear on their avatars. Which would mean Walter Trekkie would need light cast upon his face. And Lebedev would need those slightly garish sunglasses. Anyway, these two have swapped sides, just for the record. Walter Trekeriki.
Card on turn.
Picking up 3 points in that first game.
So now we are going to make big bluff. Or
danger spot here for Sergey. Hand one.
Very dangerous spot for both players, really. I mean, they put a diamond out on the river. Walter's going to be in a bunch of trouble. Kind of like Sergey had a hard time folding his marginal made hand last time. If another diamond comes out, Walter's going to have a hard time folding this marginal made hand, the 10 high flush.
What does Walter do here?
He can go either way. Raising's pretty sweet because there are a lot of made hands that can call you. But it does look quite strong. The problem is that if you just call, it's going to go check, check on the turn a lot. And then you don't get much more value. But Sergey may bluff this one.
Great check from Walter.
He has the best blocker. Yeah, we saw a bunch of leading in the previous game. I don't know if we've seen much leading at all in this game or many other heads-up matches. And that's just because leading is really hard to balance. And when you're trying to play a really strong, unexploitable strategy, you want to make sure all of your lines are somewhat easy to balance. Wow. Sergey does go for it.
You really get a bit of flush.
Should be hard to call.
No way Walter folds this in a million years.
Yes, that's why it's so big bet.
Just a flat from Walter. And a rough start for Sergey, although he picks up aces second hand.
I like to just call there from the 10 high flush in that spot. Maybe you could get called by a straight or a set, but it looks so strong to check raise over an overbet. Because when your opponent overbets, it's often a very polarized, strong range. So I actually don't mind the play by either player in that hand. I think Sergey needed to bet. He had the best blocker. He just happened to run into a flush, and you're not trying to make your opponents you're not trying to make them fold flushes there. You're trying to get them to fold out one and two pair of hands.
Interesting comment in the Twitch chat from Kitten Money Poker. I was roommates with Jonathan Little in college. He's a stand-up guy. Is that someone who you're familiar with?
I don't know who that is. I had no roommates in college. I lived in my parents' house. My room looked a lot like Walter's. I sat in my room and looked at my computer all day every day, playing online poker. So maybe Kitten Money Poker's my mom.
I mean, it's conceivable.
No, I don't think her name's Kitten Money Poker.
Is your mom on Twitch?
She is. She goes by her real name, Rita Little. She is in a lot of my streams. I have a home game that I run on PokerStars each week, and a lot of people show up and play, and my parents play. They have a lot of fun.
Follow the GPL on Twitter, guys, @GPL. Use the hashtag GPL to tweet your thoughts on what you're seeing.
This could be a tough spot for Walter, especially now that another king comes. Also, given how aggressive Sergey's been, I think he's very likely to get paid off if he goes for extreme value here.
Let's repeat the sizing.
Slightly surprising that more chips didn't go into this pot pre-flop.
No, I like to just call from ace-nine suited. If you watch some of the players like Olivier Bousquet, they're not three-betting the ace-nine suited type hands. They're just calling sing flops, trying to not get it all in dominated. So you'll see a raise and a call. And now Walter's in a mess because Sergey has been incredibly aggressive this match so far and earlier. And I think Sergey's getting paid on the river.
Yeah, this is a run out that's going to make it.
I don't hate an all-in from Sergey, honestly. It would be huge, but I think it'd be pretty sweet. Notice all the draws missed. He does go huge. Nice play. This is the kind of thing you can do, especially when your opponent thinks you're overly aggressive and maybe tilty.
Yeah, and especially if you didn't have it the previous time.
Right. I mean, like, your opponent knows you can bluff.
Yeah.
But then it becomes, would he really do it twice? And it's hard to know. You have to remember, he just bluff-catched in the previous game and lost. He's already been caught bluffing one time in this game and lost. So I don't know if these players know each other, but...
Okay, nice laydown by Walter Trekeriki.
Very good fold. He probably made the read that Sergey wouldn't do it twice in a row. And, you know, that actually takes a lot of respect for your opponent to assume that they're not just losing their mind and going on tilt. Because most of the time when you're playing against random poker players, that is a concern. But in the Global Poker League, a lot of these players are very well-versed at poker and are not going to mindlessly go crazy just because they lose a hand or two. Kind of big fold from the King-6 offsuit.
I'm wondering what the image in your bottom left-hand corner, that is not a blank screen, folks. Walter Trakariki is there somewhere. Occasionally when he rolls his eyes, you can see the whites of his eyes. That's about all you're getting from Walter, it would seem.
I don't think anyone understands, but apparently this is just how online poker players look when they're playing online.
I mean, I feel like even the light from his screen should be providing more light than what's on his face. I mean, he must have his screen resolution like turned down. It's like literally the lowest
strong hand
amount available.
Hmm. This is good for your eyes. He wants to be in the game for a long time.
GTO like eye policy, but not too GTO for our viewers.
Let's try to check raise. Sometimes he has jack and try to play small pot on flop. And if we bet turn, he just call. If we check raise, we make much harder.
Walter thinking he's on high stakes poker.
What does that mean? Oh, 7-2, I see.
Playing 7-deuce.
So Sergey has a maniacal image at this point. Obviously, he's just had good hands for the most part or good bluffing opportunities. But Sergey looks crazy to Walter. He's probably thinking, what is happening? This guy is so far out of line. It's incredible. That's what I'd be thinking if I was playing.
Suited medium hands is quite good to play. It's a bit pot in position. So we are not going anywhere. Only to see the flop.
Especially versus a small 3-bet, you have to stick around with these hands.
Second pair.
Not the best flop.
He's good against big cards and good against some small cards. He could 3-bet some small connectors. I think it is better to control the pot. Let's check.
Definitely a good check behind on the flop. If you bet and get much action, you're usually not so happy with middle pair bottom kicker. But if you check it down, you may get your opponent to bluff, as we see here, or value bet, which is maybe what Walter's doing. And you make it hard to get blown off of your hand.
Don't think he has a lot of flushes as he checked flop. We can try to find small value in some ace king or ace queen. And saying that we had something like queen check.
You can maybe get called by pocket eights here. It's another hand that maybe 3-bets you preflop. I would likely consider checking the flop.
That was really small.
Yeah, usually this is a spot where Sergey doesn't have very many bluffs. So given he has very few bluffs, he typically wants to bet on the smaller side. I mean, his only real bluffs here are queen jack and king jack. Maybe jack eight.
He shouldn't raise me here.
Pretty nice pot there for Sergey, bringing him back level on chips with Walter.
Level pegging, as you guys
level
say.
Level pegging. What else might you say?
They're even. They're even money.
Level pegging's just so much more smoother off the tongue.
It's not smooth at all off an American tongue. Never said that in my life. Until just now. Well. Silly Americans. Here's Sergey again looking very aggressive. Walter may start fighting this at some point.
I feel like Sergey's image to Walter is going to win him a huge pot pretty soon. Feel like it's sort of going to come to a head.
So this is the thing, is a lot of the best poker players are aware of image concerns, but they assume if they're playing at someone who's very good, the image doesn't really matter because I'm just trying to implement my strong strategy.
To make big faults.
Sergey seeing in the replay, Walter making the big fold with the ace nine on the king, king nine, eight, two board. No, that, and that was a big fold. I'm kind of surprised that Walter did not make the call there, given all the draws miss. When all the draws miss, it's usually not so bad to call. But yeah, going back to image concerns. If Walter's watching the stream, he's seen that Sergey actually has not been that out of line. He's had either good hands or just great bluffing opportunities. So you can't assume the guy's just crazy. It'd be a little bit different if we were playing online or live, where you can't look at your opponent's cards after 10 minutes. In which case, maybe then you do just have to start looking the guy up a time or two more often than you normally would.
Download the GPL TV application, folks, on iOS and Android. Follow the GPL on the go. Get all standings and upcoming fixtures. Access our merchandise store from the app. Download the app for hoodies, t-shirts, and caps for your favorite GPL franchise. Walter with sevens here. Okay, flop.
So Sergey is likely to bet here, given he has the backdoor flush draw and the overcard.
Sometimes we should bet.
I think with the backdoor flush draw, you typically do want to bet. Without it, I think checking becomes a much better option. Interesting run out. Sergey could have some nines. He could have some fives. I think he'd want to value bet the nines on the river if Walter checks.
King of hearts is to do it here. Not that catch. Too many draws. Some draws, of course.
This would be a pretty light call with the king high there. I think that's, you just have to get out of the way on that one. But like Sergey said, there were a few draws, mainly the bad gut shots and the flush draws.
Just a reminder, guys, Igor Kurganov against Mike Lehr coming up later. Matches scheduled for 5 p.m. Eastern, 11 p.m. Central European.
So we won't be too far behind schedule on that one. We'll hopefully be right on time.
Yeah, that match should go ahead of schedule, guys. Thank you for your patience in regards to the late commencement of this game. It was a Twitch issue, which has now been resolved.
Interesting, Walter just completely giving up on that pot. Doesn't even want to take a stab. It's not very good run out to take a stab, because you can get called by a lot of flush draws on the turn. And then on the river, you can get called by any pair, maybe even some king highs. So good understanding of that is just not a good bluff spot, even though you have a very, very bad hand.
Don't have so many experience in this kind of stacks. So fives. Two, we are too big, too sharp. Don't want to play three-bet pot. Out of position.
I actually discussed this in my book, Secrets of Professional Tournament Poker, about how this 40 big blind stack is a really tough one to play.
It's better to bet here. He has some sixes, not too much. I think it is better to bet myself here. Sometimes he has four. Maybe he will call me with ace high. Small bet.
Okay. interesting on the river. I think I probably would have preferred to check there because there are a lot of draws that could turn themselves into bluffs on the river. But there's some value to be had there. You really don't, you don't want to check and let your opponent check behind with a four. And this is what Sergey's trying to figure out. Is it better to check and let him bluff, or is it better to bet to try to get him to call with the fours and the ace highs? And those two plays are probably close. So you just have to figure out if you want to be betting more or checking more in that spot in general. And that usually takes a lot more long-term analysis than what we have here in 1 minute.
Quite often. So let's make it big C bet. This card is not good. I have second pair, first straight bar.
Walter giving Sergey all the rope. It's important to have some strong hands in your checking range, especially when the river card is a card that should be at least okay for your opponent, as that one was. So I don't mind that check. I think that's perfectly fine. You want to make sure that your opponent knows that when you check the river, that does not mean you have a marginal hand or garbage. You want to be able to check with essentially the nuts. And of course, he didn't actually have the nuts, but a straight there is a very, very strong hand. So you always want to keep your ranges strong one way or the other.
I will check here the pair. The pair is bet kicker. Also now Walter will not think I have 10 in my range. So ace is not so good card.
An interesting flop in this hand. Not quite the turn card to spark fireworks.
Still?
Yeah.
He has 8. He'll call me at least once. Maybe twice.
See how Walter attacks this spot. Being out of position with a bad draw, it's very difficult. Applies the aggression. I mean, This throws off warning bells in Sergey's head. Because what chance do you want to raise? Like ace 8 and ace 5.
So many draws here, and I'm not blocking one. I think you play top pair, just call, not with raise. So, let's do the river.
Great analysis by Sergey. Buckle up. Hold on.
Interesting bet with 7s. Quite big. It is no value at all here. He will never crazy me with 8 and then thinking to call the river. Just check.
Good check behind by Sergey. And probably a good give up by Walter. Yeah. Notice if Sergey has an ace, he's never folding. And he may not even fold a 10, so I think that was a fine spot to give up. You have to be careful check raising the turn on somewhat dry boards. And obviously there, Walter should have very few bluffs, but you know, he did have a hand that makes sense to want to check raise. And he would like to be able to check raise his nut hands as well.
I think it is a better way to just call through bet.
Bad timing for
bet here on the shove.
Yeah, great just call by pocket aces to keep
like this kind
Walter in.
With aces. It is hard to get value from queens and jacks here. Sometimes you catch king. Of course, I will call here.
Just under third pot from Walter.
Yeah, Sergey's in call down mode. He is not folding on any run out here. He doesn't love it, but at the same time, you're not slow playing the aces to try to get away from them.
Does Walter give up here?
Well, we're about to see. I don't know.
But also,
pretty much a no equity hand.
It is bad flop to bluff him. So one third of a pot. I cannot fold right here. I think he could bet sometimes with queens, jacks, tens, two times, never three.
What about queen four offsuit?
Call turn.
Interesting sizing from Walter.
Well, he's at least considering a shove on the river.
Here, I should fold.
Wow. This is going to be fantastic for Walter if he can get Sergey off
even
pocket aces.
And he gets it up.
Interesting question. I have value bet here. So, if he would have king, he probably shove half pot. Yeah? No flushes. Sometimes tens. He decided, I think I should shove. If he has queens, at least it should be a difficult decision.
Pretty fun hand there, but would have been really interesting to see what would have happened had Walter Trecchiriki elected to unload the clip. But we're all in here. Got a flip. Deuces against ace four.
Ace is good.
Sergey Lebedev takes the lead. One card away from pulling us back at one all. That's it.
Okay.
Sergey Lebedev.
1-1. That's the last one.
Pulls things back for the Moscow Wolverines.
Well, at least neither of these players will leave embarrassed with 0 points.
Yeah, I mean, that was a really fun end to that game. Another sort of slightly drawn out and cagey heads-up battle. But I think, the real interesting hand, which I'll hope you'll shed some light on for me, Jonathan, is the hand we just saw with aces against queen four. Now, the question I wanted to ask you, Walter is clearly bluffing with the queen four, and he bets a third pot on the flop. And then a fairly harmless card comes on the turn. Now, he bluffs again for third pot. Now, what hands would fold the turn that are also calling the flop? And is he just purely setting up a river shove? And if so, why doesn't he shove the river?
Well, I think you're trying to get your opponent off of stuff like ace queen, ace jack, pocket pairs, low pocket pairs, whatever the low bad pocket pairs are, like pocket sixes. I think those hands will very conceivably fold to the turn bet. They're always going to call the flop bet. They are never... they're always going to call the flop bet and often going to fold on the turn. So given that he set up the river size, that doesn't necessarily mean he has to follow through.
Yeah.
And perhaps he bet on the turn thinking that if he calls my turn bet, he is planning to call my river bet. And if that's the case, then you can make that turn bet. And if you get called, well, you know you should give up because you're probably getting called on the river. Of course, Sergey said he was going to fold his aces. I don't know if he actually was or not, but the reason he was saying that is because it would look so incredibly strong for Walter to take that line without a very premium hand. So what's a very premium hand on king, king, three, or whatever it was? It's going to be a king, right? And it could easily be ace, king, king, queen, king, jack. So it certainly would be a tough spot. He was also saying that he did not necessarily think that that Walter would fire off with a hand like pocket jacks. So he was kind of discounting those if he went bet, bet, bet. So that would have been a very interesting spot. It's almost a shame that Walter decided to give up and did not let us see Sergey make a huge fold with aces. But, I mean, I'm not folding aces in that spot ever. And if they have the king, they have the king. They got me.
Yeah, I mean, it felt like we were quite slightly deprived of a really kind of interesting river decision there. Just in terms of the overall kind of standing in this division, this was a game where, Rome could have really done with a sweep. But, I mean, the Moscow Wolverines, you know, Sergey Lebedev really pushing, putting in strong performances in his heads-up game. And he was never going to roll over for this one. I'm going to go to the second game. And Walter will really need to lock this up for 6 points if the Rome are going to climb out of trouble in this league. They've been put under a lot of pressure by the performance of the Berlin Bears. They will see the Paris Aviators playing later with Mike Lear taking on Igor Kurganov. But for the meantime, final match in this Walter Trecchiriki against Sergey Lebedev match.
Game three,
in the bottom left of your screen, in the dark.
With Ace King. And a fold from the 10-7 offsuit from Sergey.
I'm on the squeakiest chair ever made.
Sounds
like there's about 7,000 mice trapped inside, all wanting to get out.
The secret is to just stand up, and get off the chair, and then you're done. Can't make any more racket. So here we have Walter with ace king on the first hand, and now pocket jacks on the third, or
like his
first and third hand.
Far, just straights. Second 3-bet.
2 3-bets and 2 hands from the big blind. It's pretty aggressive.
Flop. Bottom why is there? It's better to check and here bet.
Little pot there for Sergey.
I'm going to fall to 3-bets hard time.
You can't let him 3-bet you to death. You have to start fighting at some point.
King is good. I'm blocking diamond. So... half pot. Enough.
It's called by the pocket twos. That's a...
I think I should bet river.
It's a tough spot to call with the twos with no diamond.
Kicker can play. So...
nice value bet there by Sergey. And a tough spot for Walter. He does make the fold, though, correctly realizing this is very near the bottom of his range. It's okay to fold out the bottom of your range. I think a lot of amateurs look at that spot and think, well, why are you calling the turn if you're not going to call the river? And the reason is because if you're calling the river every single time you're calling the turn, or very often when you're calling the turn, you're going to be calling too much on the river, and really you're just going to be very exploitable. So
offsuit queens, you need, small one.
You need to fold out some hands on the river that are... traditionally considered to be made hands.
I will 4-bet if he's 3-bet here.
Sergey's ready to fight. he's ready. Doesn't like getting 3-bet two times and two hands.
I'll defend my... small top pair.
Get away for Walter. When your opponent comes out firing, again, if they're a good player, you just have to assume that they picked up some hands to some extent. Of course, they may be 3-betting stuff like Jack 4 suited or Jack 3 offsuit or 5-3 suited, but at the same time, they probably just got two hands that are in their 3-betting range.
It's high flow. Always interesting.
At GPL, use the hashtag GPL to join in the conversation.
Would bet some river, but not this one.
Yeah, this is definitely not a good river to bet. So,
not many bluffs from me.
Don't forget to download the GPL app, available on iOS and Android. Follow the GPL on the go. Get all highlights and full reruns of all matches played so far in the GPL. This is match 132.
It's a lot of games.
A lot of games. A lot of great strategy.
It's 9-5. I made big bluff yesterday. Not today.
Sergey referring to the 9-5 suited handy played versus Fabrice, which we did a strategy segment on. Make sure you catch that between the games. Today, between the matches, we analyzed that spot. It was an incredibly sweet bluff. Both these players, they come off kind of nice and relaxed, but I think they both have a huge amount of fight in them.
Oh yeah. I mean, yeah, we've got a Rome emperor and a Wolverine.
Yeah,
playing out in front of your eyes.
The back darts. Okay. King comes a turn again.
I can tell you one thing about the Rome Empire. He didn't back down too easily in the face of conflict.
Give us some history. Tell us something about Rome that we don't know.
I mean, the Roman Empire was the biggest in the world. The biggest empire ever.
It was not wise for betting me.
Besides America.
It's king, jacks.
And Britain.
I mean,
Britain owned everything.
Nothing comes close to the Empire of Rome, Jonathan.
Yeah, back then America didn't exist.
Indeed.
It wasn't even on the map.
Still a bad shot.
Yay for Christopher Columbus.
You ever listen to the podcast Hardcore History?
No.
Oh, you might enjoy it if you like history.
I do like history.
Check it out.
I'm a graduate of history.
Oh my God, check out Hardcore History. You'd love it.
I will do.
Fantastic podcast. I listen to a bunch of podcasts. And that is a fun one. Each episode's about 4 hours long. And often multiple parts.
A little bit, yeah.
So 5 parts, 4 hours long each. Going really deep on a specific time or a specific thing.
Great, yeah. No, I mean, always looking for interesting podcasts, especially as I spend a bit of time on planes.
Oh yeah, if you ever are on airplanes, you want podcasts. Or if you go to the gym or anything like that, you want your podcast. Let us know what your favorite podcast is in the Twitch chat. Make it a good one so we can listen to it. Don't tell us it's a podcast about kittens or something like that, unless you really want a podcast about kittens. I
mean, what you mean is, let us know what your second favorite podcast is, because obviously everyone's favorite podcast is the Jonathan Nuttall podcast.
That's true. Weekly Poker Hand, I have a podcast.
There you go.
Each week, I post a poker hand, and I talk through it, and
numbers.
I kind of do what I'm doing here, except for it's on a podcast.
Small bet, yeah.
Here, Sergey has Walter in bad shape.
Definitely some interesting turn cards here. Jack. Yeah,
we want to see, for fun,
uh-huh.
a three of hearts.
Bing!
Yeah, close.
No bigger.
It's a tough spot for Walter, because a lot of hands that Sergey decided to bluff on the flop, like 7-6 with a spade or something like that, now have to bluff. They have to bluff again. Sergey does pick a big sizing that makes it a little bit more likely that he is polarized to some extent. And I think Sergey can go for another straight of value on this river. This river's effectively a blank. It's very hard for Walter to have a king.
This is not many kings there. Sometimes, of course.
Yeah, like king 5 he could have, but that's pretty unlikely. Definitely a value betting spot, I think. I think you could even go a little bit on the bigger side here to try to stay looking polarized.
He has queen. He'll call me, of course. Probably with some fives sometimes.
Big fold from Walter. Twice he's made folds to Sergey in this match that I thought were certainly possibilities to call, and they've been right both times. Actually, 3 times now I'm thinking about it. Three big folds from Walter, all 3 correct. Sergey's a nit, I guess. Sergey just has it. Any man who has a shirt that colorful is not a nit. I'm just going to throw that out there. People always ask, how do you know how a guy's going to play in live poker when you just sit down? Well, is he dressed colorfully?
Look at their shirt.
Does he seem like a fun guy? If he's a fun guy, it's probably not tight.
Sergey Lebedev is the highest ranked player on the GPL to be playing in the heads up tonight. Forty-six on the Global Poker Index.
Oh, I remember when I was number 46 back in the day. The good old days. Then the Germans happened.
What I meant to say was the highest ranked GPL player to play tonight so far. Of course, Igor Kurganov is 26 on the GPL. GPI, sorry.
Here we have a pretty big hand happening.
quite big.
Tough luck for Sergey to get no action there. Kind of surprised he went so big. Maybe a spot to make your to make all of your sizing a little bit smaller there. Walter picking the king two offsuit to get out of line with. It's perfectly fine. It's a hand that's pretty tough to play from out of position. And you have the king blocker, which is reasonable. We'll get to play a pot this time. Just give us a flop. We need the flop. Sergey doing some business on the side. Psycho, hello.
Call or raise.
Pretty impressive showing from Walter so far. I've only seen him once in the heads-up element of the GPL. That was in the cube where he went 2-1 down to chance corner.
To start.
Went 2-1 down. Ending. That means he lost?
Yeah.
Okay.
Lost 2-1 against chance corner, but he's put in a mixed bag of performances in the six max. Had a second place and a third last night. But a couple of fifths and a six. So he's a player who's certainly got a bit, you know, a bit of work to do in terms of his GPL stats. Yeah, running at 27% of total points available earned. That was before yesterday's six max.
So it's probably creeped up to about 35 or something like that?
Yeah, tiny. I mean, a small amount. Yeah, put in a third place for, yeah, probably crept up to around 30.
A little bit surprised we didn't see a defend there with the king seven offsuit. Maybe that's because Sergey has not been three betting very much. If your opponent's not three betting very much, you should be pretty tight versus their three bets, assuming you think their three bets are for value, because people can play
limp shove.
Oh well, let's take a look at this. Maybe we get it. No limp shove. Instead, just a bad flop for Sergey.
Yep.
Some people will raise mainly with their or three bet mainly with their garbage hands, and then call with all their good hands. And against that person, you don't want to be folding to their three bets, but If Walter thinks that Sergey is very tight three betting, then you really don't want to be calling with hands that are very easily dominated, like King 7, for example.
That's definitely not the first time that Sergey has limped, calling to planning to shove over a raise by Walter, but he hasn't taken the bait so far. Haven't you seen the explosive flops in this game that we saw in the previous game between Jeff Gross and Guodong?
Yeah, these players being a little bit more measured, trying to not blast their stack in after the flop with marginal made hands. They are playing much more defensive strategies. And there's nothing wrong with a defensive strategy. I think that's important to note that this is probably poker that is much more difficult to take advantage of. A lot of people try to put their money in anytime they have anything reasonably strong, but you'll watch a lot of the best players, they either want to have very strong hands or they want to have a lot of bluffs, and it's sort of a different strategy that does take a while to understand and comprehend, but once you do, you can really just beat up on your opponents pretty much no matter what they do.
Yeah, I mean, as you've, you know, outlined a couple of times this week, you want to ramp up the variance when you feel that your opponent has an edge, rather than when you know, if you feel that you have an edge, you want to sort of minimize that variance.
Right. So here, Walter, again, elects to just check. Walter seems to not raise the limps very often, and I think that's a fine strategy. Mainly because whenever you raise the limps, you're giving the limper great odds to call in position. And, like, say you raise the three big blinds after they limp, you're basically saying, I don't think you're going to win more than 33% of the time in position. And they are. So it's a situation where You have to be somewhat cautious raising the limps, unless they're just going to let you run them over, but Sergey's not going to let you run them over.
Currently one each in this Eurasian heads-up match. Sergey Lebedev against Walter Trecheriki. Apologies for the potential butchering of Walter's name from both the commentators.
I didn't even try for a long time.
Yeah, I mean, Walter's a lot easier to say.
Lebedev. Sergey Lebedev. Walter Trecheriki. That's me in my horrible American language. Doing my best. So, blinds have just gone up. 6-12. Really, one difference between this match and the previous one is that both these players are not at very good hands.
Yep.
They've had a bunch of garbage so far. Not much has happened at all. And, you know, the thing is that whenever you see people making big bluffs, if their opponents happen to have decently strong hands when they attempt that, just
lines
due to
going
variance,
up, cards going down.
That's exactly what I just said. Whenever you attempt to bluff, if your opponent just has nothing, there's not going to be a big pot. You just pick up a small pot. When they do have something and you attempt a big bluff, that's when you end up getting stacked. So, anyway, so far all the bluffs have succeeded, and everyone has had pretty much garbage.
Yeah. Finally.
Look how happy Sergey is.
Finally picked up a draw.
But notice here, Walter has nothing, so there's not going to be much to this pot. Both players thinking, okay, this is a whole lot of fun, getting a bunch of garbage. But this is what happens when you play poker. And you have to be prepared for whenever you're playing a multi-table tournament. You can go 6 or 8 hours with one or two playable hands.
Oh,
and even
yeah,
then, you'll just raise and you'll steal the blinds and that'll be it. So you have to make sure you're always stealing any pot that you have the opportunity to. And also, you just have to make sure you stay sane. You have to not lose your mind, not get on tilt, and just try to play intelligently.
Barring here.
Yeah. Or sounds it sounds so easy. Just sit there and be sane. How hard could it be? I think you have to manage your emotions. You have to manage your expectations. I think a lot of people think when they go to play poker that they're going to get a bunch of good hands and win all the money. And most of the time you're going to go to play poker, you're going to get a bunch of garbage hands and you're not going to win money, especially when you're playing tournaments. So you have to have reasonable expectations and understand that, you know, bad variance happens and good variance happens sometimes.
Planned the check raise flop. No. No.
Both these players perhaps fighting the emotion or the desire to get well out of line.
This is the penultimate GPL match with Jonathan Little in the commentary booth. We're sad to say. It's been an absolute pleasure to be treated to his wisdom for 5 shows in a row.
Well, thanks for having me. I've enjoyed it. We may see some fireworks here. Although, Sergey does keep it small. But yep, one more game for me after this.
It's a good one.
Yeah.
Mike Clare against Igor Kurganov coming up tonight, guys. 5 p.m. Eastern, 11 p.m. Central European time. Do not miss that one. Two of the very best.
To Sam. I don't like the size of C-bet.
Tough spot for Sergey. He has to defend here a decent amount of the time, but at the same time, this is a spot where he's going to get barreled off his hand a lot of the time on the turn and or the river. Odd Gog, thanks for the kind words.
Let's try to attack.
We do our best.
The commentators are sick. There we have it, folks. We are sick. In the good sense. We're not sick. As in, a, you know, debilitating disease of some kind.
Notice here in the past, this is a spot where quite often both players would be happy to get it all in for very deep stacks, but not in today's game. Notice Walter just calls, and if he gets nothing, he's going to get out of the way cheaply.
We'll see that. Not giving him free card.
So make a little value bet just so that you don't let random queen jack get there and outdraw you. And if your opponent does want to call a queen jack, that's fine because they're putting in money slightly bad most of the time. Notice there you don't need to bet huge because if you bet huge on the flop, your opponent will be getting... Well, your opponent will start folding out their queen jacks. And then you're only... That kind of implies you're only getting called whenever you actually have the worst hand. Walter does not go for a bluff on the river.
Three-quarters pot for Sergei. Really not like Walter can do here.
Well, you say that.
It's like he's rolling his eyes. Which, no, yeah.
Reluctantly folding. Misclick, he says. Don't misclick. We saw some misclick action from Jeff Gross earlier. It did not work out. Well, one of them worked out, one of them didn't. Here we have... Finally, two monster hands. Pocket kings and Jack 10 offsuit. Jack 10 will see a flop, though.
Let's see.
Again, though, nothing. I mean, this is what we've been saying, where you know one guy gets a good hand, the other guy gets nothing, or one guy tries to bluff, the other guy has nothing. And, you know, Sergei just has to get out of the way.
A lot of constructive comments coming in on the Twitch, which we like to see, folks. Keep those coming in. So tell us what you like. Tell us what you don't like about the GPR. This is season one of the GPR, guys. Always looking to learn and improve.
Anytime you want to be useful, always make sure you're giving constructive criticism, not just one guy can't form a sentence and the other guy's too British. You know, don't say things like that. Make you know, try to help us with things that we can actually improve on.
I think too British is... It's fairly constructive. I've been accused of being too British on many an occasion.
I love the adios at the end of the strategy segments.
Yeah, I've been trying to dilute my Britishness in the strategy segments we've been doing, just to balance things up a bit. Always taking on board feedback.
Sergei binks it right on the turn. He's going to try to induce a bluff. So Sergei can definitely get value on this river, even though it did run out where there is an obvious straight flush. But I don't think anything's going to happen this time, again, because Walter has nothing. Walter seems to be getting pretty flustered by just not winning any pots. So here it is. He's doing it. He pulled the trigger. We called it. Yeah, Sergei's calling.
Call 8 deuce flop. Check, check, and check raise. I think good spot for me. Good bluff with king of diamond or ace of diamond. Maybe.
And he lets it go.
Wow. Big fold by Sergei. I'm not going to say that was like a tilt raise or anything on the river, but that was a very optimistic one from Walter.
Yeah, he's definitely shown some tighter tendencies, especially in this last match. Certainly pre-flop. But probably getting a lot of credit there from Sergei. In a spot where, I mean, a nice bluff card given the flush and the straight came in. But I thought Sergei would probably make the crying call there.
Yeah, that was one of the better hands Sergei could have. But he made the fold. You know, he's probably just gave Walter a little bit of credit.
Could see some chips going in here. Walter elected to call again.
it's interesting to see how you, like Walter's facial expressions are changing a lot, whereas Sergei seems to be pretty consistent in his demeanor, which is interesting. Like, it was clear to me Walter was going to do something on that river. I mean, like, whenever he raised in a spot where it's certainly not standard abs, you could, like, just look and tell. This is a guy who is tired of it.
Yeah.
And this happens in live poker sometimes.
Yeah, it's a spot in live poker where it would have been very interesting to see whether Sergei would have made the same decision, given, you know, table dynamic and game flow.
Well,
and you can, because often you can sense a player is, you know, moments away from a sort of a blow up of some sort.
Yeah, and I mean, if Sergei could have seen Walter's webcam, I bet he would have called no problem.
Yeah.
But, of course, neither of these players can see each other, so they don't really know what's going on. So the players have no real incentive to not hide their emotions. They can do and say whatever they want.
Which is what we want to see.
Yeah. You want to see the guys really happy and really annoyed. And like Jeff Gross in the previous game, match.
Jeff Gross.
It was a lot of fun watching him go from really high to really low to high again. He had some emotional swings.
Yeah, Jeff Gross, definitely at the top of the tree in terms of players going through the... all the ranges of emotions for their GPL franchise, guys. If you haven't seen that game, check it out. Follow our YouTube channel, Global Poker League. It will be available on the GPL app, GPL TV, available on iOS and Android. Really one of the better games so far of the GPL.
Here we have what we've been waiting for. Top pair versus top pair.
The cooler, the 10-3, 10-8 cooler. Probably be a chop.
Roland wants to be here all night commentating. Let's just chop it up. And it is going to be a chop. Good call. They both win a whopping 0% of the time. Notice just
that call.
Well, that's an important situation where if Sergei raises, is he really getting called by very many worse hands? Like, probably not. He's never making a 10-fold. I don't mind that call, although maybe there's value to be had.
Really nice flop for Walter here. Shouldn't see Sergei in too much trouble.
Walter does have king high and a backdoor straight draw, but that's not such a good hand. On boards like that where the flush draw is available, or the backdoor flush draw is available, you want to start with a spade in your hand so that you at least have that potential.
Three kings for Walter Trecchierichi. We three kings.
Does it work sometimes?
Sergei electing to check on this king three pot. Going to get raised and the snap fold.
Raise nine without
Sergei getting the bad news.
He's thinking, what is happening right here? How do I lose this hand? So he sees the bad news and he goes all in.
He's too creative.
Too creative. My friend. Two hands failing to connect with a flop. Not for the first time in this heads-up match.
So we're 49 hands into this match. And I would bet that we've had no pairs. Something like 38 of the hands out of 49 to some insane number. So two players doing their best to stay sane. But here we are. We're down to 20 big blinds each. And, well, someone's going to win an all-in at some point. Sergei doing everything in his power to let Walter put some money in the pot, but... it's hard to put the money in the pot with a 10-2.
Just a reminder of what's coming up later, guys. 5 p.m. Eastern, 11 p.m. Central European time. Mike Leia of the Paris Aviators taking on Igor Kurganov of the London Royals. Yeah. My pronunciation has deserted me. Really interesting games we've seen so far with these two.
the next match, if you've never watched Igor, Igor is not afraid to fire. He will blast off his stack, no problem, if he thinks the moment is right. And so we've had no real cards on this game, but both these players have not been too keen to just fire off too willy-nilly. But we may see some fireworks in the next match because Mike Lea is not afraid to make a big call.
Yeah, Mike Lea is a guy, from what we've seen, I mean, and in his career, what we've seen on the GPL so far, this guy very rarely makes the wrong decision in a hand.
Yeah, he's a great player.
He thinks it through, and he just gets to the right decision, which is, you know, a real kind of key factor in what's made him one of the best players, you know, for the last sort of 5 or 6 years on the North American tournament circuit. Meanwhile, Sergei with top pair in this hand. Walter River's a tiny little piece.
Tiny little piece. This may be just enough to get him to call, given all the draws missed and all the ace highs may decide to bluff this river. So I would not be shocked if he looks up Sergei on this one.
Okay, there's a queen.
Another big fold by Walter. Four big folds by Walter so far in this match, in my opinion, and every single one of them has been correct. So, if Sergei's watching this, which I know he is because I can hear myself in the background, I would definitely suggest that he starts... Well, he's going to run out of time in this match, but in the future, if you ever play against Walter again, I would probably start making more river bluffs. It seems like Walter is not paying off river bluffs or river bets. So, if you see that every time you value bet the river, or often when you value bet the river, you're not getting paid... That should induce you to start bluffing the river way more often. And if you are a recreational player listening to this and watching this, ask yourself, whenever I get my big hands, are my opponents paying me off? Or are they always folding? And if they're always folding, or very frequently folding, that likely means you're not bluffing nearly often enough. That's a very easy adjustment that a lot of poker players can make. If your opponents fold every time you get a big hand, well, means you have not put in the action to justify them giving you action when you get a good hand. So push it until they start fighting back. And whenever you make a big bluff, they should be failing sometimes, which is terrifying to a lot of poker players. They do not want to make a big bluff for all of their money and have their opponents call them and lose. But one thing you can learn from watching the Global Poker League is that when these players commit to their bluffs, they are willing to go with them a lot of the time and play huge pots with nothing. And, you know, more often than not, their opponents do fold, but sometimes they get called, and that's that.
You heard it, guys. Push it good. Push it real good. Get looked up every now and again.
Yeah, get looked up every now and again, and then play all of your big hands equally fast. Let's see if Sergei goes for river bluff. He does not. Just another tiny pot.
And the stacks are even after hand 58.
It's almost like they blinded off for the last 58 hands. They just traded the blinds back and forth.
And neither player flop a pair in this hand.
So either they flop nothing or they flop bottom pair.
One time.
Sergei may have to peel one time.
Good.
And he does. And a great turn card for Walter. He will be making a bet most likely.
Still neither player with a pair. Walter picks up the flush draw and will probably feel confident enough to continue his aggressive line in this hand. That's half pot, just above. No, just half pot.
Now Sergei ditches it. Remember, that's a hand that's effectively at the bottom of his range. He can just get out of the way. Call flop and then get out of the way. Sergei may just fold this preflop, but he does decide to put in the limp.
Walter shoves, Sergei folds.
So now Sergei is getting pushed down a little bit. The blinds are about to go up one more time, and that's going to really put Sergei down to the 10 or so big blind range, which is not where you want to be.
Going to see a flop. Neither player flops a pair. And Walter Turikiriki takes it down.
Oh, hands dull. 10 big blinds.
As you heard there, Sergey down to 10 bigs.
Blinds are now 16-32. Fun blind sizes here at the Global Poker League. Why don't we do 16-50-33 next level? You want to do that? With a 336 ante?
I think we want to eke this one out. Let's put in some more levels.
All right, sure then.
Limping's perfectly fine from the button if with a hand like Jack 7. You don't really want to shove it. It's a little bit too large of a shove. So that's a spot where some people like to just limp.
It'll be hard to win. Running bad.
Notice Walter getting all the cards right at this exact moment when Sergey needs the cards the most. Kind of a snug fold from the 10-4 suited. That hand's almost certainly good enough to at least limp. 6-2 offsuit is not good enough to limp. Six. 9-4 offsuit's another folding hand. If Sergey gets tricky and limps, this could be it. But he likes to jam instead. Aces. Yeah,
come on.
Notice Sergey has chipped up a little bit to 12 or 13 big blinds. That's going to make these queen threes not necessarily shoving. Interesting, Sergey limps a hand that I think it's a perfectly fine hand to limp. Well,
oh,
I was going to say, it's kind of interesting that he decided to limp with this after the other strategy he was using of shoving or folding for a few hands. But this is going to be all she wrote, most likely. Unless Walter does something really fancy play syndrome-y, I think this is going to be be the game.
Fold. No more folds. If you catch three, okay.
Pretty safe turn card.
Yeah.